You may have noticed as you were reading the daily worship guide this week, or you may have noticed this morning as Allie was reading our passage for us, that there's going to be some devil talk this morning. And I know that for some, this is a topic that creates fear and anxiety. And so let me encourage you, as we dig into our passage today, I want you to keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Look at not only how he engages the devil, but also look at how he engages a mob stirred up into a devilish frenzy in his hometown. Jesus is the very epitome of what Jewish psychologist Edwin Friedman calls a non-anxious presence. Jesus is a non-anxious presence in the face of the devil and of this mob who are ready to kill him. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, led by the Holy Spirit. Jesus, living in the power of the Spirit, shows up and announces confidently that the Spirit of the Lord is upon him and that he has arrived and come to do the Lord's work. Confident. This is the Jesus that we fix our eyes on, confident in the word that his Father spoke to him at his baptism. Jesus knows that he is God's Son, and he knows that his job is to do the Father's will. Jesus is also confident in God's definition of him as he faces the devil. Jesus then faces men and women of his hometown, and he doesn't let the devil or his fellow Nazareans define him. He doesn't let their anxious agendas redirect him from what God has called him to do. He is God's Son. He is led by God's Spirit. He is victorious. And I don't know if you believe this, but we can be too. Do not be afraid. If you have your Bibles open, I want you to turn to the book of Romans. Surprised you there. You thought I was going to say Luke. Romans chapter 8. So if you're in Luke already, go over to John, pass through John, through Acts, and there's Romans. Romans chapter 8. Verse 14, Romans is a letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to churches in Rome 20 or 30 years after Jesus. And one of the things that Paul is attempting to do is to help Christians understand, young Christians understand their place before God and with God. And he spends quite a bit of time developing this argument. But we're just going to read his conclusion because it's stinking amazing. And it's a good summary. And so chapter 8, verse 14, we read this. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons and daughters of God. All who are led by the Spirit of God are sons and daughters of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons and daughters, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. I want you to notice this phrase, the spirit of slavery that Paul is talking about. We'll come back to that later, but Paul keeps going here, and he says, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if we're children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Whew. Paul is saying that sons and daughters of God have been given the Spirit of God and that they are led by the Spirit of God and that they will suffer with Jesus and also be glorified with him. This is kind of big. So then think about what Luke might be trying to do for us at the beginning of his gospel. Luke now is writing 20 to 30 years, not just after Jesus, but after Paul has written to the Romans and has been trying to convince these young Christians that they are sons and daughters of God and that they should live by God's Spirit. As Luke says at the beginning of the gospel, he has researched all of these things thoroughly. And after his research, Luke has made decisions about what to include and what to leave out in the story, not because some things are more important and some things are less important, but because there's a way to tell the story that helps you focus in on the majors, the important stuff. And one of the details that Luke clearly emphasizes is this link that exists between the Spirit of God and Jesus as the Son of God. And so Luke is writing, if you remember the intro to the whole book, to Most Excellent Theophilus. Not totally sure if it's a name or if it's a general title. It could also mean lover of God, friend of God. But whoever is receiving it, Luke wants this reader to understand how Jesus was able to live the way that he did. How is Jesus able to live in the way that he did? It's not just, hey, go and act like Jesus, because we quickly know that, like, we fail at that a lot. That's hard. But it's deeper. Be who Jesus was. It's quite a bit different than act like Jesus. It's not that difficult to imagine that 4 or 5 decades after Jesus has come and gone, that some in the church would begin to grow weary, that some would lose faith, that some would begin to question their identity in Christ, that others would begin to give in to the temptations of the devil, that some would begin to resist living by the Spirit. The further the distance between Jesus and that example, the easier it would be to be like, did Jesus really do that? Is that really how Jesus lived? And so decades later, Luke writes, and he does so to invite these people into a fresh vision of Jesus, to see Jesus and to see the way the Spirit enabled Jesus to face the devil and to face his enemies. If you want to know Jesus and if you want to follow him, you have to understand that his confidence and his power came from God's word and God's Spirit. God spoke his word, you are my son. And God's Spirit then led the son into the family business so that Jesus gave his life to doing the will of his father. Jesus knows who he is and he knows what he is supposed to do so that when the devil or Jesus' own family and friends want to redefine him or redirect him, Jesus resists without fear, without anxiety. As we read Romans a few minutes ago, we heard Paul tell us that this is exactly what is supposed to be able to happen to us and in us. That as we respond to God's invitation to return to him, the invitation that we heard Tom offer us last week through John the Baptist, come, turn your lives back to me. That as we respond to that call, God is eager to receive his people. He calls us his children. He gives us his Spirit. And so we, like Jesus, get to walk with our Father, doing his will as we are led by his Spirit. Luke is trying to persuade us. He is trying to persuade the lover of God, the friend of God, Theophilus, to see Jesus and to say, I have been called a son of God. I have been called a daughter of God. God is enabling me to imitate Jesus. I don't know about you. Does that sound pretty good? Like a life worth living? So here's the problem with imagining ourselves living out this sort of Jesus-looking, empowered, devil-defeating life. And it's actually sort of a big problem. We just spent the last year reading Joshua, Judges, Samuel, and Kings, and well, we know how that worked out. God referred to Israel as his firstborn son. He talked about the Israelites as sons and daughters. He even gave guys like Samson his spirit, and we know how that worked out. Without kings, Israel spiraled into chaotic anarchy. With kings, Israel spiraled into despotic oppression. God's people always turned towards other gods. They rarely obeyed God's instructions, never for more than a generation. And these four books that we read last year were when Israel had everything. These were when life was good. They had the land that God had promised them for so long. They had every good gift from God available to them. They took it all for granted and kept turning to other gods, other sources for life and faith and salvation. But we also know, don't we, from our experience, that yeah, of course, when they had everything, they didn't trust in God. It's when we have nothing that we're more likely to turn to God when life is really hard. Well, just a few years ago, we spent our time in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, and we followed Israel through the wilderness where they had nothing, and all they had was God to rely on. But they couldn't trust him to provide the food that they needed. And since they couldn't see their God, they kept testing him again and again. And then they get to a place without water for the second time, and they just start to grumble and say, God, you brought us here to kill us. You hate us. We know it. We hear these stories of weakness and failure. And I don't know about you, but there's something that sort of connects with us about these. They feel really human. Like, yeah, I get that. They sound way more familiar as visions of the way life tends to work out for us than the vision we see in Jesus. Right. We resonate with the Israelites in a way that we struggle to with Jesus. We look at Jesus and we go, oh, he's so godly and he's like all holy and he's so pure. And like, you know, he's everything above and beyond everything we could ever attain or live up to. And so we just get tired looking at Jesus sometimes. But Luke is trying to convince us that Jesus lived as a man, as we live, a real life, flesh and blood man. And that part of what Jesus came to do was to show how real life people might live the life that God made us for. That like Jesus, we have been called sons and daughters of God. That like Jesus, we have been given God's Holy Spirit to fill us, to lead us, to empower us. I don't know if you've ever seen this lived out in someone that you know. Someone who refuses to be anxious about what's in front of them. Someone who has just a profound confidence in their identity as a son or a daughter of God. Somebody who seeks to live by the power and leading of the Holy Spirit. I remember the first time I saw it. Or at least the first time that I understood what I was seeing as it played out in front of me in real time. Some of you have heard this story before. When Jane and I started dating, I was still a pretty new Christian. Like I'd been barely at this thing for like 2 years. And it's probably enough to just say that I had never had a single healthy romantic relationship. And Jane was a few years older than me, and so a little bit more mature. And Jane and I are about a month into this thing. And I basically start to do my typical sort of freak out, wig out sort of thing. And I start to get all nervous because of how serious it's getting. And I start like doing weird stuff, like drawing away and making excuses about just being lame. Pretty much it. And so she says, well, we need to talk. And so we're sitting in my car and I start repeating all of the lame excuses about where I've been. You know, school's been so busy and blah, blah, blah. And she responds in a way I'd never encountered, ever. She basically said something along the lines of this, I like you. I said, yeah, duh. And she's like, and I'm enjoying this relationship and I'd like to keep it going. And then she said, but I don't need you to make me happy. I know who I am. I know that in God's eyes, I am a princess and I deserve to be treasured. And it sounds like you've got all kinds of things that you're interested in, which is totally fine. But if we're gonna do this, you have to be in. And I expect you to treat me as special. What? Who says that? So, wow, I think applause, well done. So, she generously gave me a week to think about what I wanted. And here we are. I win. No, I'm just kidding. Kidding. I have to say something this morning. Some of you have heard this story. I've shared it before. But about my own place in this story. Generally, when I've told it, actually every time I've ever told it, I've focused on Jane's conviction. Her sense of being a beloved daughter of God who was worthy of someone who would treat her like that. But we do need to also name what I was doing. I was the devil, standing before her, calling her to settle for less than what God made her to be. It's not every day you hear your pastor call himself the devil, eh? Aren't you so fortunate today? But this is exactly what I was doing. Exactly what I was doing. I was walking in the spirit of the devil as I tried to get Jane to change the way that she understood being a daughter of God. I was walking in the spirit of the devil as I tried to redirect her from the path that God had her walking. Truthfully, I have often thought back to that conversation and I've been amazed by the way Jane responded to me. But I've never once looked back at that conversation and been as sort of horrified by my own part in it as I was preparing for this morning. And I don't know if maybe you think that I'm being too hard on myself. Maybe devil is too strong of a word. But if you spent time with the Lord this week using the daily worship guide, you've already begun to think about how this works. This morning we read two stories side by side. The devil tempts Jesus in the wilderness and the people of Nazareth tempt Jesus in his own hometown. Both stories, they start out really similar. In chapter 4, verse 1, we find Jesus is full of the Holy Spirit and he is led by the Spirit into the wilderness. And there, his hunger, as many of you well know, makes him vulnerable to suggestion. And then we get down to verse 14, where Jesus comes to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and he announces that the Spirit of the Lord is upon him. And he's there in a place filled with family and with lifelong friends and neighbors, people he trusted. Maybe you know this as well. Jesus is in a place that's vulnerable for suggestion. In both of these passages, the words from Jesus' mouth are almost entirely from Scripture. He starts, he quotes from Deuteronomy three times. He reads from Isaiah. He references stories from Kings. In both of these passages, the question of Jesus' identity is raised. In the wilderness, it's raised pretty explicitly, if you are the Son of God. Now it's important to understand that we hear that question as like accusative, like you're not really. The Greek that's at work behind our English translations says it with the, like, if you really are the Son of God, as you say you are, like this, let's assume that you are this, then do this. And so, but this question of what the Son of God is supposed to do is what is raised. And then in both of these passages, there are these similar temptations, and invitations to tempt Jesus to use the Spirit to accomplish this range of tasks, right? Like if you had the Spirit of God, if you had the power of the Almighty God in your hands, like what kinds of cool stuff would you do with it, right? I mean, in some ways, this is the list of the things you might do with the Spirit of God if it was available to you. And in both of these places, Jesus is tempted. What might you do? All of these things are contrary to God's will. At the end, then, of both of these passages, here's where you see the connection in its sort of fullness. Jesus winds up on a high peak. In the wilderness, it's the pinnacle of the temple. It's worth saying that Luke is commonly assumed to be the last of the Gospels written. Luke and Matthew are the only two of the Gospels that actually list out the temptations. Most scholars are convinced the order that they come in Matthew are like the real order, that Luke has switched the second and third, the assumption being in order to get Jesus on the pinnacle so that you see the connection with what comes next. There on the pinnacle of the temple, the devil tempts Jesus to jump off of it. In Nazareth, a crowd takes Jesus out to the pinnacle of a cliff where they are ready to throw Jesus off to his death. The only real difference between these two passages is that the devil is the tempter in the wilderness, and then the devil isn't mentioned at all in Nazareth. It's Jesus's closest friends and family who continue to do the work of the devil for him in Jesus's own hometown. This is kind of huge. Luke will later tell us that there are people who can be possessed by evil spirits, but there's no attempt to like make us think that every single one of these people is possessed by the devil or of an evil spirit. Instead, we're not supposed to see them as possessed. We're supposed to see them as enslaved by the devil, that they are unknowingly walking in the spirit of the devil. They are living as children of the devil, and they are enslaved because they do not even know it. In verse 5 and 6, we read that the devil offers Jesus the kingdoms of the world. And the devil tells Jesus this, I will give you all of the authority and I will give you all their glory, for it has been delivered to me and I give it to whom I will. And we don't really know if authority has been delivered to the devil so much as he is speaking the truth here. The devil has a demonstrated authority in our world because authority exists wherever someone follows. We had a board member who moved away a couple years ago, but he had the best one-liners. And he used to say, a leader without any followers is just a guy out for a walk. And I just always loved that, right? You don't have any authority if people don't listen to you. You don't have any authority if people don't follow. And if there are those who will follow the ways of the devil, then he has authority. The people of Nazareth are so powerfully under the authority of the devil that the devil doesn't even have to come into Nazareth and like start whispering into people's ears. He doesn't have to like suggest what they should do. It just seems that the people of Nazareth do what's natural to them. They tempt Jesus as well as they know how, the way that just comes naturally. There's a couple different ways to think of what these three temptations were and looked like, or how they apply. Henry Nouwen describes the devil's three temptations as the temptation to be relevant, the temptation to be powerful, and the temptation to be a spectacle. Another way to break the three temptations down would be to see them as a temptation to provide for yourself, a temptation to seek glory for yourself, or a temptation to gain power for yourself. However you understand these temptations, the idea is that the reason Jesus is tempted by them is because he is walking a completely different path. He is walking a completely different way. He is led by a completely different agenda, and he has completely different motives and objectives, so that providing for himself, seeking his own glory, using his own power, are not things that he's doing or trying to do. And so they are temptations to him to change the course that he is on and to reconsider the purpose of his calling. The thing for us to notice is that the people of Nazareth aren't tempted by these things. They are already normal to their way of life. They have already given into them. For them, it is normal to look out for your own interests. For them, it is normal to seek fame and glory. It is normal to protect yourself. And if these are normal, well, they're not temptations for you. These are just what you do. And if Jesus is going to be their leader, then he needs to be able to do these things better than anyone. Mostly, he needs to look out for them. And so you can still see in their questions a self-interest in them, that this is who they are. The devil's influence in this way, then, is about an attitude. It's about a mindset, a way of thinking. It's about a worldview. It's about a way of thinking that the people of Nazareth don't even question. To that extent, Jesus and his alternative mission and the strange teaching that comes with it is so uncomfortable and disorienting to them that they then are riled in a fury and they are ready to kill one of their own. Not just a fellow Israelite, this Jesus, whose father they know, who grew up in their midst. Just as I did when I pushed Jane to settle for less than what she was made for. The people of Nazareth push Jesus to settle for less. And in so doing, they and I were walking in the spirit of the devil. But I do think that there is a difference. There's a difference that can be seen in one of our favorites, Peter, one of the closest of Jesus' disciples. I know you're familiar with this, as we were just in Matthew somewhat recently, but Jesus explicitly calls Peter Satan and says, "Get behind me." And the question is why, and the answer resonates exactly with what we're seeing in the people of Nazareth. Because Peter was tempting Jesus to abandon God's will. Peter was attempting to redirect Jesus on an easier path, an easier way to settle for less. And so he says, "You're doing the work of the devil. Get behind me." Later, this same Peter wrote a letter to some young churches, much like Paul did. And near the end of the letter, he will say, "Do not be anxious, because God cares for you. Be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour." What's Peter's advice to him, to them? Resist him, firm in your faith. Something has happened to Peter from bumbling, stumbling Peter who's walking with Jesus and is told to get behind him because he's proposing the devil's ways in front of Jesus, to Peter who's calling these young churches to resist the ways of the devil, to not be anxious. The Peter who was held captive to his devil-inspired ideas about who Jesus should have been, that Peter has been set free to trust who Jesus actually is. The Peter who was blind to the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdoms of the world, that Peter has been given sight and can now see. The Peter who was oppressed by the devil's small and limited imagination has broken free and could see that while the devil appears to be a lion, all he can do is roar, "Our God is the lion." The devil is not to be feared. He and his small ideas, his selfish attitudes, his destructive values, his glory-seeking ways, they're actually quite obvious for those who have ears to hear and eyes to see. The problem is, Jesus says, "I need to give you those eyes. I need to give you those ears so that you can see and so that you can be free." When we resist the devil, we don't do it passively, but with courage and mostly with the power of God's Spirit, so that we hear Jesus' words in Nazareth a little bit differently as he stands up in the synagogue and he opens the scroll of Isaiah and he reads, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty those who are being oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Jesus rolled up the scroll and he gave it back to the attendant and he sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him and he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The people he was speaking to, being held captive, being blind, being oppressed, they could not see the truth that it was them right in front of him who were in need of being set free. They needed the Spirit of God and the fire that Jesus promises. As we make our way through Luke in the months to come, leading up to Resurrection Sunday, I just encourage you to watch how Jesus sets his people free. Watch the way that he does it. It is beautiful. And the invitation to be set free is available for us today, so that we can watch people like Peter, watch people like Jane. In Romans, Paul makes it pretty clear that when you have been set free, you can still choose to walk by the spirit of the devil. And so if as followers of Jesus, we find ourselves having our eyes reopened to the path that we have been walking on, it is not that we have to somehow fear whether or not we are still sons and daughters of God. But we have chosen that way. But we are no longer slaves to it. And having eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts that have been made soft, the hope would be that as we are confronted in the ways in which we are walking in the spirit of the devil, that we would choose the spirit of God, that we would choose life. As we think about what this means for us, there really is only one way to respond. And it's the same way we respond every single week. It's the same way we begin to respond, and that is to come and sort of symbolically participate in our sonship in God's family. As we come to the table, we take little pieces of bread and we take little cups, and these are just small symbols of the meal, the family dinner that God is inviting us to come and to find our place as sons and daughters alongside Jesus. And so this morning, I don't know what your prayer is. I don't know if your prayer this morning is, I want to walk in the spirit. I have been walking in the spirit of the devil. Maybe your prayer this morning is, I want to become a son of God. I want to become a daughter of God for the first time. Whatever your prayer is, I want you to know that Jesus and his love and his grace invites you to come and to find fellowship with him. But there's something important about that invitation. The reason we take the bread and the cup is to remind us of the death and the resurrection of Jesus. That it is through the death of Jesus, it is through the resurrection of Jesus that our redemption, that our freedom has been made possible. And so we come to the table remembering that Jesus has done for us what we could not do for ourselves. And so makes a place for us in his family.